Did you know that about 20% of the power in the United States is provided by 54 nuclear plants all over the country? Well, today we're in the tiny town of Arco, Idaho, which is the first town anywhere in the world to be powered by nuclear power. We're gonna be showing you the nuclear power plant where this all started here in Arco. And we're gonna be showing you some quirky things in this town that is proud to call itself the first town powered by nuclear energy. And on a sadder note, we're gonna go about 20 minutes down the road to Atomic City, where the first and only nuclear explosion that resulted in death in the United States took place. Are you a bit freaked out by nuclear energy? Hopefully by the end of today's video, you won't be as freaked out. Or you might be more freaked out. Who knows? It's time to let go and get going. Okay, we're getting the kids up. We're getting ready to head out.
There was one in the bed and the little one said, roll over.
And I can already tell you, this town just feels unique. So check this hill out. I cannot remember the name of it, but I'll put it on the screen. But the graduating class from Arco, for every year since 1920, climbs up on this mountain edge and like paints in the year that they're graduating. I mean, from back here, it doesn't look very tall, but these are dozens of feet tall. Really cool, like one of the coolest like high school traditions I've ever heard of. But does nuclear power freak you out?
Yeah, when I hear the word nuclear, it's typically like a positive word in my mind.
So hearing the word nuke does not tickle your fancy? So the underlying story with all this is, like a lot of things in the 50s and 60s, the United States was actually somewhat competing with the Soviet Union.
I must break you.
To advance in technology, like they were also racing to get to the moon and racing to do things. Well, nuclear power was also something they were racing to have, was to figure out a way to harness the energy of the atom and be able to power things like cities with that power. This is obviously built out in the desert, like not near a lot of stuff. Feels kind of creepy for some reason. It's so creepy.
What have you got us into?
So this became a National Historic Landmark like within a year or two of after it closed down, which says a lot, because usually it takes way longer than that for something to become a National Historical Landmark. All right, you're going first, Inslee. I don't know if I even want to step foot in here. Here, buddy, I know you like these. So this is what they were looking for in order to build this facility. They wanted isolation, water, transportation, cities and towns, weather and wind, geology, and government owned. Thus, 1949, they built this facility out here, pretty much in the middle of nowhere. Wow. Let's go, go on in. I don't know what's going on. Oh, it just shocked me. It literally just shocked me. I don't know what just happened. I think I was.
Oh, it shocked me.
Look at it.
Oh, you can't get near it. How do you turn it off?
Back up, JJ.
I don't know. There were no instructions.
Oh, don't touch me.
It felt like an electric fence shock, man. Yeah. There were no. I assumed it was safe.
It shocked me, but I'm okay.
Like a static if you rub your feet on the floor and pop somebody, but it's good. It's
yeah,
a good
there's
one.
No warning.
There's nothing. I just thought, well, there's a button. I'm
gonna I thought it was one of those things. Do you remember when you used to go to the
yeah.
Science Museum? And you would...
I think they put that right in the beginning to let you know, don't just start touching the buttons.
I just can't believe that's there with no warning. What is going on?
So here's kind of the diagram of what's going on with nuclear reactors. The quick, dirty way of how this works. So they're splitting the atoms. That creates a reaction. That creates steam. And then the steam turns the turbine, which gives the power. So this entire facility was created as an experimental facility. It was never really meant to provide large amounts of power to anywhere for long periods of time. However, it did provide power to Arco down the road we just came from for about 60 minutes in the dead of the night just to see if they could do it. And so this was sort of step one. And so they shut this down in 1955, and then they started building a larger facility we're going to show you later. Well, what's left of the larger facility they built later down the road.
Oh, wow.
This is where it all happens.
What is this?
Control room.
The control room. It says feel free to push buttons.
Maybe. Yeah, right. I'm not pushing nothing. JJ, this is your wonderland. You can push all the buttons you want.
It said push the buttons. This is like a kid's playground.
I think this is all real, man. Isn't that cool?
Look at this, Dad. This is the emergency button.
He's walking around.
Push it. In case of emergency, this is the scram button. It would shut it down instantly.
This is really cool. It's actually not very often we go to places like this. They're usually like recreated or you can't touch the actual thing. Like just to walk around, you touch anything you want here.
This is the actual logbook of Dr. Zen.
Like you gotta be in charge for names. Dr. Zen.
Everything's just so
analog. It's like, it reminds me of, you know, look at Apollo 11 and the old spaceships, like, and even airplanes to this day. It's just tons and tons. Look at all these physical buttons. I love it.
Hensley said her goal was to push every button in here.
Yeah, more buttons.
Evacuate alert.
What's back here, guys?
See it? That's the reactor core. I mean, that's it. That's the guts of it right there. That's
all right,
the head of it.
You're standing on top of a nuclear reactor head.
Weird.
You can see it. It's visible. See it?
So they like manually regulated how much is being split and how much power is being created by raising and lowering rod on this nuclear reactor. How much you raise and lower that rod determines the heat that's in the heat zone, so they're trying to contain it. But if you want to turn the reactor on and off, you've got to raise and lower the rod. And we'll talk in a little bit how that went really wrong in the facility down the road.
Four ordinary light bulbs came to life. They were the first bulbs ever lit by electricity generated from nuclear power.
Can you imagine the excitement when the light bulbs went off?
Like, that's what they say, like the bulb went off.
The bulb went off, right? Like that brings a whole new light to the phrase, a light bulb went off.
This is an original bulb right here, this one right here.
Yeah, so in 1951, the day that this happened, they put their names on this wall in chalk.
And then in 1955, the female names were added. JJ.
Turn that back on.
Not that button, buddy.
Yeah, so the drawing of the whistling man is by crew member Reed Cameron, who was inspired by Zen saying, if a man can whistle, he can generate steam. Yeah, it's up at the top up there. I wonder if it's one of those things, because you picture they're here for like, if they're here for like 5 years, if Zen's walking, like, we know, if you can whistle, you can produce steam. You see how they got an order? Turbine moves, produces electricity with the generator, lights the light bulbs. So if you're evacuating, like, which I don't think you'd have time to do, but evacuation route.
This is evacuation.
So this is where when the atoms split, the heat would convert it into steam, which again is going up to those turbines, which is going to the generator.
Something about this feels kind of wrong, I don't know.
There you go, are you two scientists?
Hensley, is that the scientist face? What are you doing?
Yes.
Do you see how thick the glass is?
Yeah, oh my goodness.
And they would use these mechanical arms.
See, I'm using the arms to keep him safe.
This is how they would inspect and repair the radioactive rods.
Look how thick this glass is.
It said the world's first mechanical hand. To be able to see the first, you know, arms used for manipulation, and now all the things we use them for, like we literally save lives with how we can use these mechanical arms and be so precise. It's so cool.
Like this isn't a replica. I mean, they put a couple of canisters in there and some rods.
It says shine a light to see how thick that glass is.
What in the world? That just...
Yeah, it just
freaks me out. Yeah, I don't know what's going
on
right now.
It shows how thick the glass is.
I mean, I'm kind of looking down here at the bottom and I can kind of tell because it says, what, 39 inches or something?
Why do you think it's doing that?
Is it thick?
Yeah, because how thick the glass is.
The lasers.
The light's just reflecting all over the place.
Pew, pew, pew.
Do you guys want to do a laser fight?
Yes. Yay, laser fight.
You guys fight.
Pew, pew, pew.
Hold it up. There you go.
Knock over the beakers. Pew, pew.
This is an official part of the tour, right? But...
Got it.
You got it?
Mm-hmm.
So we got three levels.
Can I find the last one?
That's great. I'm loving the signage here.
Is it different
historical value only.
Located the locker room. This is where the operators cleaned the radioactive coolant off the rods that came out of the reactor before they were placed in the rod farm to cool.
Oh, it's like an elevator.
You can go like, you can go like everywhere in here. It's in here. Oh wow.
Still see how thick that glass
is?
What's this in the ground here?
I'm ready to get out of here.
So they're all in the repair room. And I guess that's
hello.
Okay, so we mentioned that they built this as the experimental reactor. And then once this one worked out, they built the more long-term reactor 5 or 10 minutes down the road, Atomic City. There's just not a lot here. So this is Atomic City, which at one point had hundreds of people and families moving in to work on the plant, live in the area, until everything went wrong. And now it's pretty much a ghost town. So instead of hundreds, I think the population did go up the last census from like 30 to 41. So back behind me, and you can't get over there anymore. They've closed off the road, and you can't really see it from here either. But it's back there. It is the second site that they built off of EBR-1. They came and they built a more permanent nuclear site called SL-1, like maybe five, 10 years later after they built SL-1. This is super coincidental, this excavator's out here. So what's left of SL-1, which is really nothing, is back this way about a mile. They built this as a follow-up to be more of a permanent structure to supply more power, and it was. So basically, after Christmas vacation, they came back. It had been shut down for a while. They had to turn the reactor back on. So this is a three-man crew. One person moved the rod. One person clamped the rod to help make sure it stayed in place and didn't go too far. And then the third person kind of just was a spotter. And this is a big deal because if you move the rod 2 to 4 inches, you're okay. But if you move it, let's say, 20 inches, boom. What happened was the rod had been sticking over 7 times in the last month. The person who was pulling the rod up, well, when he pulled too far on the rod that was in the reactor. Within 4 milliseconds, boom. But all 3 of the men died from this explosion. And then they came in, they destroyed the entire reactor, and they buried it in this land right behind us. They estimate it takes about 250,000 years before it stops being reactive when something like this goes wrong. Although it's a tragedy of what happened with SL-1 with the explosion and the 3 deaths, that is actually the only nuclear reactor incident that resulted in deaths that the United States has ever had occur. I think instead of manually pulling that rod out, they now use computers more to do that. They have all kinds of safety features. And nuclear power supplies the United States with about 20% of its power, and it's used worldwide to supply power as well. So we're shifting gears a little bit now. We're heading back into Arco, where we're staying and where there's restaurants, and there's actually some quirkiness to the area around being the first city that supplied nuclear power. It's one of only a few restaurants in town. It's called Pickles. And they have...
Pickles.
They have pickles, I hope. Okay. And they also have something called the Atomic Burger.
Oh. I'll do some fried pickles. You want to do some fried pickles?
They're famous.
Got Atomic Burger, Crater Burger, Idaho Burger, Pirate Burger. I'm definitely doing it. I'm doing the Atomic Burger.
You can't come to a place called Pickles without getting a pickle, right?
So this is a small order of fried pickles. Ainsley, gonna try one?
No.
No.
You're going first.
Mommy's gonna go first.
One for each.
Mm.
I need this.
Good. All right, so here's the Atomic Burger. Of course, pickles on the toppings. Another pickle. I got a side salad. I got mushrooms, grilled onions, cheese. Looks pretty good. Marissa's going all healthy on me over here.
Well,
grilled chicken salad. It looks pretty good.
Yeah.
What'd you get, JJ?
Chicken strips. Corn dogs. Daddy asked me again.
And?
French fries.
What'd you get, Nissa?
Chicken strips, tater tots, and a pickle.
A pickle.
What'd you ask me, Hensley, about my burger?
Is it radio awesome?
Blows my mind.
That was good.
That food was mind-blowing.
Let's go.
Atomically awesome.
Alright, we got one more stop. It's right over there across the road.
This section is safe.
We're good. I think we made it. Whoa, buddy. Look at that. What is that, buddy? Yep, it's the top of a submarine. I don't know if they renumbered that, if that was the original number, but that's a...
It could be changed.
Look at this thing.
Look at this thing.
Mark 14 torpedo.
Yeah. You guys are cracking me up with the torpedo here. Really is 666.
Says it was out for 29 years.
Now the Hawkbill, known as the Devil Boat, you know, was not powered by nuclear energy,
but it was really active during World War II, and it patrolled the seas with torpedoes looking for enemies. If you want to tie in the nuclear story with this,
because they love their initials, the NPSSRP, Nuclear Powered Ship and Submarine Recycling Program. They're even using nuclear power to recycle submarines once they're decommissioned. Marissa's 29, so that means you graduated in...
I don't remember... the year I graduate. Whatever makes me 29, that's
so it changes every year?
That's the year I graduated.
Okay, yeah. All right. Yeah, that makes sense. Look at 64, those overachievers on 64. Oh my goodness.
It was a good year. Good
I
year.
Guess. So they're, yeah.
So are you, after today's walk around video, are you more afraid of nuclear power or less afraid or neutrally afraid?
I think anything, if you have a better understanding of something, it helps you appreciate it more. It helps you maybe overcome a fear a little bit of it. So
it's very insightful.
Yeah.
For a 29-year-old.
I mean, yeah. I'm wise beyond my years, but...
So if you've never heard of Arco, Idaho before this video, we highly recommend checking out another video from a city that has a population about 10 times smaller than Arco, but it is an outdoor oasis. It's on the edge of the Sawtooth Mountains, rivers, streams, kayaking, mountain biking, hiking, off-roading, anything you could dream of in this tiny little town called Stanley, Idaho. We highly recommend checking it out.